Hello there, friends, and welcome. For this new Deadfire video, I want to cover some very powerful tips to help your character, even if you are a beginner, to easily handle Deadfire's hardest difficulty, Path of the Damned. Alright, so for my first tip, I want to teach you how to maximize not only your offenses but also defenses through the power of stealth. The beauty about stealth in Deadfire is that it lets you make attacks and achieve extremely fast recovery time. As you can see here, we have a minus 85% from stealth, which pretty much lets you use your action and immediately after that recover for another action, whatever you want. The first thing you should do is set auto-pause to enemy spotted. Combat start can be neat too. Now start with everyone from stealth. For those that do not know, the left alt key will change your characters between stealth and unstealthed. Because we spotted the enemies, the game has auto-pause for us. Now, send your tank ahead as close as you can get to the enemies. Notice that they have this big circle around them. So long as your characters stay outside the circle, they will not be detected at all while under stealth. Yoti here, for example, only has 3, but you can even do this with 0 stealth, at the very least for ranged attacks and spells. This will gather the enemies around him, and since all other characters are stealthed, they will only target a dare, perfect for tanking. Now here's a fun fact, because our characters will not be detected by the enemies, who are busy with a dare, we can keep on spamming buffs forever or also summon creatures again and again while remaining under stealth, since these aren't exactly offensive spells. For the spells that have very low casting time by default, you can basically spam them one after the other. What I like to do is start, for example, with Litany for the Spirit, for a bonus to power level and intelligence to characters that cannot cast Infuse with Vital Essence, so are not wizards. Alof, on the other hand, can cast all of his wizard buffs, so Vital Essence, Spirit Shield, Alacrity, and lastly finish with Merciless Gaze. After all of this, he'll still be able to cast an offensive spell while undetected. Being able to instantly cast buffs again and again and summons is basically perfect. So let's actually start the battle. So Shoti actually already spent her 2 slots with Litany for the Spirit, one after the other in quick succession. Now we can go for the classic Devotions for the Faithful, and right after that Dire Blessing. All of this will be done one after the other. And like I said, because all of the enemies are here, and our characters are way beyond their field of view, they cannot detect us at all. Now when it comes to offensive actions, I'll have Teke who cast Great Maelstrom here. You will, after damaging the enemy, come out of stealth. There are some exceptions, however. The spell Delayed Blast Fireball, for example, because it will create a projectile that lingers here until it explodes, it's not considered an offensive spell, which means you can basically chain this again and again with little recovery time. All this in the same round. Elof has already cast the first Delayed Blast Fireball and has still retained stealth. So the next one, we retain the bonus from stealth by having less than half a second recovery. Shoti has cast Devotions from the Faithful and can go right after into Dire Blessing, so she's already started casting it, while also remaining in stealth. Because of how many free actions we get with this, it is very easy to completely ruin the enemies. They were already bursted by 2 delayed fireballs. That's why I say this spell is way better than it seems at first. Anyways, there's not much the enemies can do now. For my second tip, let's talk all about buffing your accuracy and debuffing enemy defenses. In Path of the Damned, the enemies have quite higher stat values. This is where buffing comes into play. I've noticed a lot of people say that classes like Wizard are not really good, mostly because they just expect to start the battle by already casting your powerful offensive spells like, let's say, Fireball. When in reality, to succeed, you truly need to not only buff your accuracy, but debuff the enemy. Only after that is when you should start spamming your crowd control or offensive spells, otherwise chances are they're going to easily miss. For example, Alof's Case of the Adragon has 45% chance to petrify Uamoru without any buffs. Now let's see how it goes after we increase his accuracy, or 58% in the case of our Cypher main character for Amplified Wave. With just Devotions for the Faithful, we already have 55% for Alof and 68% with our Cypher. Now it has become 73% from Dire Blessing, stacking with Devotions, and 60% for Alof. That's certainly around plus 20 to accuracy from just these 2 simple buffs, which can matter quite a lot. And of course, we haven't started on the debuffs. For example, Uamoru has 97 Fortitude. So let's have Shoti go for Shining Beacon. to reduce it even further. Now he has 87 from Shining Beacon, which then has increased our Cypher's Amplified Wave to 90%. Another example, Jadar Phelas the Ancient Red Dragon has 108 Will and 110 Fortitude. Let's see how easily we can reduce that. By just having a dare attack with the Great Will Breaker Morningstar, we already reduced it to 85 and 185. Now let's go for Borrowed Instinct with our Cypher and Wilting Wind with Alof. Now his Fortitude is at 65, while Will 106. And we have Confounding Blight, Thunderous Report, Borrowed Instinct, Chill Fog, Wilting Wind, Thyme Parasite, Recall Agony, and lastly, Adair's Weapon Effects. So that's quite a lot of the buffs we have going on. Let's just add a Disintegrate. There's nothing really the poor Red Dragon can do to survive. Alright, so let's cover another very important tip now. Food bonuses, and trust me when I say they can really change the gameplay into your favor. There are plenty of food recipes in the game, you don't actually need to find a recipe, you already start knowing all of them. When it comes to tanks, I really like going with Captain's Banquet. The extra damage with spells doesn't really matter, unless you are a spellcaster tank, but most importantly, everything else is great. Plus 20% action speed, so you attack faster, but what really makes this food shine is the immunity to all mind afflictions. So immunity to intellect afflictions, which is great because, well, if your tank is charmed or dominated, enemies will basically bypass his engagements and just rush for your backline. Immunity to perception, so your tank doesn't take reduced accuracy from, let's say, blinded. And lastly, immunity to resolve, as you not get frightened or terrified. Because tanks really have to hold the line, I really like going with this recipe. It's not that hard to do too, however, it is far easier to buy the items besides rum, which is plentiful. It is very easy to buy the ingredients from certain merchants, like for example, the marketplace vendor at Dunaj, the same place you meet Captain Ferrante. That merchant definitely sells both Luminous Lobster and Oysters. If you don't get them to spawn, because the stock tends to be random, you can just wait a full day right in front of the merchant and the stock will have respawned. If you want a more DPS-based melee character, then Hot Razor Skewers are also decent, as they grant plus 2 to might, plus 1 to all power levels, which is massive, and last but not least, plus 2 penetration with weapons. Now when it comes to spellcasters, we have another very powerful recipe, Crusted Swordfish, which I actually give to all my spellcasters. It gives not only plus 20% area of effect, which is quite powerful for all casters, plus 10% damage, very good as well, since bonuses to spell damage are rather rare. But most importantly, a very hefty plus 2 penetration with spells. You might have already noticed that enemies on Path of the Damned are not only more numerous, but they also tend to have very high armor rating. And to get our damage area of effect spells to properly hit the enemy with full damage, we need to bypass their armor. This is where Crusted Swordfish comes. Just this plus 2 eventually is more than enough to let you penetrate enemies even at the early game for great amounts of damage. And remember, Deadfire is not a game where you have to rest a lot, as your abilities tend to be all per encounter, so they will regenerate for the next battle. This way you can truly maximize the time spent with your food bonuses, certainly more than enough for many areas at once. Crusted Swordfish is also great in that you can acquire it extremely early. All you have to do is buy it from the food vendor at Neketaka's Middle District, so Periki's Overlook. He actually has infinite amounts of it for sale. For another helpful tip, we have summons. Summons in Deadfire are all temporary, but they do make for quite powerful allies, especially when it comes to creating choke points to ensure the safety of your backline. For example, this Kobold cave here has an entrance here, which is somewhat of a choke point because it is tiny, and also a bigger sideways path here where the enemies can come to flank us. So here's what we're going to do. Right after battle starts, you can already begin casting your summons. My favorite one by far is Maura's Writhing Tentacles, mostly because it summons 3 tentacles, so very easy to block the enemies with them. Let's for example cast one here to prevent the enemies to come from this side. If you have 2 wizards, it's even better because you can have 2 of these for 6 extra summons. Tekihu also has some summons, so now because of all the summons we have, there's really no way the enemies can get you where our characters are. So you can truly start by unleashing all your powerful spells. Now my last tip comes from party composition. When it comes to Path of the Damned, I really like to have a single tank with four remaining casters. For example, I have Tekehu as a druid, Shoti as a priest, Alof as a wizard, and lastly our Cypher to truly complete our party, spellcasters-wise. The reason is simple, it's very easy to have all of the enemies lock onto Adair, with your casters starting from stealth, and most importantly, all of your casters have very powerful area of effect spells that you can use to easily cripple and damage the enemies, sometimes even just getting them all with an Alpha Strike in around 2 turns. For the early game, your characters of any class read will have accuracy problems. While a melee character can like at most attack 2 times per round when dual wielding, your spellcasters have very powerful area of effect spells, capable of hitting multiple enemies even as soon as level 1. Sure, you're bound to miss some of these attacks, but like I said, they can hit multiple enemies if not all of them. Meanwhile, for a melee character, it's gonna take a while before you're very effective, and if you miss your 1 or 2 attacks, well, you basically wasted your round. Trust me when I say that with a party that's mostly spellcasters, you really have a much easier time beginner-wise against Path of the Damned. Alright friends, so this was it for my Path of the Damned guide. Please be sure to comment if you think I missed on something or have anything else to add. And as always, please leave a like and subscribe even to help support the channel if you can. Thank you for watching and see you next time, friends!